The whole reason for bringing the barbers on campus, I mentioned this earlier, but not to this extent, is that we want to present to you an opportunity, the Arctic Research Platform. Michigan State is building an Arctic Research Platform. These groups are uniquely interested and engaged in making this happen. And we call it a platform because we think that is very representative of sort of an openness to this. Whatever your major, whatever your area of study, your area of research, whatever brings you to this table, you'll find other teammates, other people who could collaborate with you and perhaps complement your research. So eventually, we're hoping to, not eventually, like right away, right now, we're hoping that you're envisioning some area that you're particularly interested in, and then we want to help you find funding for that research and help you build a team that could come together around that idea. Okay. So I think Dr. Barber gave an amazing presentation that sets up that platform. So thank you for that again. And so now I want to introduce you to Michelle Reddy, who is with the Department of Community Sustainability, and she's going to introduce our next speaker. So thank you, Michelle.
Thank you, Jordan. It's a privilege to introduce our next guest speaker. Lucette Barber is the Research Associate and Manager of Communications and Outreach at the Center for Earth Observation Science at the University of Manitoba, where she oversees and promotes outreach and communication within the center. She was instrumental in the development of the School Explorer program, which is a national outreach program that's led 8 successful expeditions in the Arctic thus far. And as many of us in this room are experiencing, scientists are increasingly being asked to engage policymakers and the public with our research findings, to engage the public with our research generally, and also to continue to build capacity within the science community. And all of that takes a lot of time and a lot of resources. And thankfully, we have Lucette with us this morning to help share some of the collaborative approaches that the science teams at the center are undertaking in order to maximize resources and to enable creative communication and outreach strategies that hopefully we can take home to MSU here. So without further ado, please welcome me in
So thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation to come and speak to your group. I kind of fell into this position when David was, if you remember David's slide where he shows in the 2000s, if he just stayed just a one person man, it would have been just really flat. And then as in the 2004, when we got the ship, things started to grow and move up at that scale and that graph. And it, as you grew, it became more necessary to that you needed some kind of a communication or outreach strategy. So I started working at the University of Manitoba in 2004. And that was just as we got the Amundsen. That was the year before we got the Amundsen. And we were going to test out the first year-round science project. And we were celebrating the fact that we had got the Amundsen and discussing it with friends and family. And amongst the group was a group of communicators and educators who said, well, that's fine and dandy for the science community, but how are you going to connect this with the rest of the world and with particularly high school students and educators? So that's how I kind of fell into this role and this position. And over the years, since 2004, and as you saw David's graph grow, through the years of IPY, through the development of the Arctic Science Partnership, my career has pretty well grown with that. And I'll show you some of the things we've done, the successes we've experienced, and the diversity of the things we've done. Because as we get more money, more capacity, as the messages become bigger and more important, more urgent, we've been able to grow and do some pretty creative things in terms of communications and outreach. So I will begin. Just a reminder of where we are as from the University of Manitoba. We're here in Winnipeg. And this link from Churchill and gives us our link to the Arctic, really. People ask, why do we study marine science and research out of the prairies. So this was one of the main reasons. This is as the years have developed. These are the research areas of our group at the University of Manitoba. So, you know, we've got access to a lot of interesting projects and a lot of stories to tell. When David talked about forming the new faculty, with the new faculty, we moved into this new building. And at the time we were at this yellow, we became the Center for Earth Observations. We occupied the fourth floor, and this was the top floor of the building. And after being successful with getting a Canada Research Chair, that involved the entire building of a brand new floor on top of this building, and it went from end to end, including, and we kept maintained this space here. So it just shows a little bit of the growth in our group in terms of physical space. We have some now very unique, very specialized labs and some really wonderful, we have a full theater that we use for communication, for lectures, for special visits, beautiful floor, wall-to-wall offices, state-of-the-art facilities and labs. Like David said, I want to bring some of these slides back just to show you, not to go into detail about each individual, but all of these represent a number of different stories. And like David said, everyone here focuses on sea ice, they're coming from it from quite different perspectives. And so as a communications person, I see this as many, many stories, and especially these Canada Research Chairs here. These people come with a lot of capacity, and a lot, most of it, they get those positions because the science they're doing is significant and it's relevant for society. It's relevant to communicate. So this is Soren. David spoke to him about him a little bit. With Soren, we were able to draw him from Greenland and from Denmark. And my position changed as he came on board. So I've gone from the coordinator of the Schools on Board program, which I'll explain right away, to now the communications person for the Arctic Science Partnership. And I oversee the Schools on Board program with the new program coordinator. So that's a little bit about me. This is at the Arctic Science Partnership, as David talked about. Partner institutions are Denmark and Greenland. And we have a communications team now, two members from each of the partner institutions, which are Greenland, Denmark, and Manitoba. And we now have new associate members with the Avi Institute in Germany and the University of Tromsø in Norway. And we have a small communications team that our role was to develop a website that would, you know, communicate the news, some of the stuff that was going on, our research campaigns. It's both an internal communications platform for our teams, but it's also the way we communicate to the world about what we're doing. So my talk today, I'll talk to you about things we're doing for communications and education, general communications, and then engagement as well, because I understood from the summary people who are going to be attending that they're quite interested in how we engage communities and the public. So, like I said, first, how I got started with working at CEOS was through the education and how do we connect the work that we're doing scientifically with science education in Canada. So we started a program called Schools on Board. And the idea of that program was to target high school students from across Canada and bring them on board a working icebreaker for a two-week period where they would engage with scientists and learn about the many different ways that they study the Arctic and climate change. It's been running now since 2004. Our last year is this year. It's very much an Arctic Net outreach program based at the University of Manitoba. Every year we get a group of students, they're a team of 9 students from across the country. A third of those positions are reserved for northern communities. And we bring 2 educators on board. And the idea was bringing the schools on board, not just individuals. So it happens during the school year, which makes it difficult for everybody. But by doing that, we engage the entire school into the program. And it's actually the schools who apply to us for space. That was by design right from the start. So that when you take a scientist off the ship to bring a student on board, you can justify that better when you say the whole school is behind this. The schools provide an outreach plan, what they're going to do before, during, and after with their student. And it's really a one-year engagement with the school the whole time.
So can you like FaceTime or Skype these classrooms in?
Very difficult because of where we are. The challenges are, they do have internet on board, but the bandwidth is reserved for science. We can do some of it, but we don't promote it because otherwise our kids would be on FaceTime and Skype all the time. And so, yeah, it's been, it's something that we can, and we've done interviews with media, and we can arrange those kind of things. But we don't promote it as something that we can do on an ongoing basis. So we've won, you know, it's been a successful program. We've won awards for it. The idea of the program is to promote science education through authentic and simulated field experiences. And with the ship, this is images from the ship, kids working very directly with scientists. This is authentic. As the program grew, though, we realized we can do more. We've got capacity in our center. We can target, get more kids. We're only reaching, really, technically, 12 kids every year. So the outdoor, we started promoting basically out of University of Manitoba, a program called Arctic Science Day. And this is doing the very same thing out of a lake just 20 minutes from the university. It's an outdoor education center, and we bring a team of 35 scientists every year down to this lake to work with, and it's an annual, it's a yearly project that we do, and I'll talk more about it in a bit. But the idea is authentic experiences in the Arctic in an outdoor setting. In 2015, after 10 years of doing this program, it was really successful, and I come from a program planning background. And I wanted to understand why it was being successful, so I did my master's at the University of Manitoba and studied our project and did a full assessment on the project to try to understand what it was that was working, how it was connecting with science education and how it was being successful in creating research partnerships. So we were asking very basic questions. The full report is available here. I don't want to get into detail. But it really gave us some insight into why this program was successful, and we could tell the world that yes, we had reasons why it was. We had some good data to support it. We were very we managed to get 63 of our alumni to participate. So if you think there's 9 to 10 kids per year, out of the 95 people that we could find addresses for, email, et cetera, 63 replied to the online survey. So we had a very good response rate. Of those 63, every year was represented in every region, so east, west, and north was represented. And so we felt that the results that we got back from that group was very strong. And these were some of the early results that we could then show the science community that the commitment they're doing to this outreach program by freeing up space on board the ship was worth it, that we were impacting kids. Like this is just taking the three participant surveys from 2009, 10, and 11. And each of these numbers represents a person. And this is a sort of before and after. And these are just examples. There's a few. I just shared a few results of what we were finding. This was self-assessment in their interest in research. So before and after in knowledge of oceanography. And you can tell this, you know, not very many high schools, particularly in Canada, study oceanography unless you're right. So they came in at a very variable rate, so right here, fairly low in some cases, and then at the end felt that they had learned a lot on board the ship. And we have similar, like there's like 8 different modules that we should show very similar changes in kids and their self-assessment. During the 10 years of the program, in 2008, during International Polar Year, we had a little bit of we had more money available to us to run a few extra programs. And we thought it might be interesting to do a Circumpolar Inuit Field Program. And this was all Inuit Field Program. We targeted older students after interacting with some of our northern partners, saying that was an age group that was a good age group to target because they're sort of looking at careers and where how they're going to get engaged beyond high school. And it was a very great program. We had students from Canada, Northwest Territories, Nunavut, and Nunavik. Our 3 regions were represented. We also had someone from Russia, Alaska, and Greenland. And it was kind of a test pilot to see how we would do it differently than if we dealt with older kids and all Inuit. We learned a lot. We worked with people from their national organizations to actually lead the program with us. And it was extremely successful. We had a whole traditional knowledge component attached to this program that we didn't have as much with the other programs. The students came on board. They had to collect traditional knowledge prior to coming on board. So they had to interview a grandparent, an elder in their community. They came on board the ship with that knowledge. And then the first part was a workshop, a knowledge exchange workshop in Inuvik, where they met with northern leaders and exchanged the knowledge they had from all these. They compared what each of them had learned from their elders, and it was very interesting to see the exchange. And then once on board the ship, they did a whole traditional knowledge exchange with scientists. So we had one night after they had spent a whole week with the scientists. The last day was a knowledge exchange. We brought two elders from Sax Harbor and the young students, and they met with scientists, and the conference room on board the ship was full. And it was just this exchange of science between the youth and their traditional knowledge. So it was a program that we learned a lot from, and it formed we now have a model of how we could do this if we wanted to do it again. So we've used the Schools on Board program to do a lot of different things, to test out ideas and to try to always stay on the top of and be creative and change. One year we had we were informed that the ship would be in dry dock. So we had a coordinator. We still want to continue the program. So we partnered with the Churchill Northern Studies Center and said, would you like to test this program with us? And it worked out really well. You're familiar with Leanne Fishback at the center. This was just before IPY, or just after IPY. And Leanne had often thought that she would want to collaborate with Schools on Board to do a very similar program out of their center. So this center is based in Churchill, Manitoba. They house and support researchers from around the world who are there year-round in different projects. And so we've treated the center like we would the ship. And it was we used the same model we did in the ship, interacting with scientists at the center. Again, we didn't know how successful it would be, but the students, honestly, who were on board this program were just as enthused and changed and excited about their experience as the kids that have been on the ship. So again, it was successful. We know that we could do it again, and it was at a fraction of the cost of going on the ship. And so we know that this is a nice model to work with. The other collaboration we did, like I said before, was we wanted to do, how can we maximize what we know, the model this whole interaction of creating experiences between high school students and researchers. Because one thing that's happening in science education, there's many studies and international studies as well that show that science education is still successful. The kids are performing at high levels, but they're picking careers that are not necessarily in science research. They're looking at the careers and their options in computer science and medicine. And so there is this need. There was in a couple of papers was science as a career, as scientists have to start promoting these careers to young people. So that was why we targeted grade 11, 12 students who are just at the cusp of making decisions what programs they were going to go into. Do they want to be a field researcher, or do they want to end up in Silicon Valley working on computers? Like it's those kind of choices that we wanted to influence. And it was mostly about also introducing them to careers that they, like the guidance counselors in schools, don't really know all the diversity of careers that are available out there. So it's amazing when kids come on board the ship and they interact with those students or come to this facility and interact with our graduate students, our researchers from all these different disciplines. Some people consider themselves oceanographers, some are chemists, some are. And when they can influence them and just show them what it is they do and that these are different careers that link to what they're learning in high school, in their high school science. So we started Fort White Alive as an outdoor education center outside of Winnipeg, and it's it was just a great collaboration of they provide us the center with their staff, and we bring a team of 35 scientists. And for one day, we invite schools to send up to 10 students and two teachers because we want to bring as many schools as possible to this event. So every year since 2009, we've been doing this. We're getting about 200 high school students a year from 15 to 20 schools. And it's been a successful thing. For us, our group, it's a real team building thing. We go out on the ice, we get out of our cubicles, we go out and spend a day showing people what they love doing. And it's the passion rubs off. And it's been a collaboration that's been very helpful because Fort White Alive is like a lot of outdoor centers. They cater a lot to young kids, so kindergarten, middle school, max. And they found that they weren't really targeting and capturing those high school kids. They weren't coming to the centers, and they weren't coming with their families or teenagers. And so now we've got every year, we've got all these high school kids coming. And so it's been a win-win situation for Fort White. They get a whole, the target audience that they're not reaching out to, and we get a facility to work our, I think, from. Now, in 2000, as we approach 2018, our funding for Schools on Board program will end with ArcticNet, or will shift or change as ArcticNet changes. And so we're not sure what that's going to be. But again, it's just like, it just gives us an opportunity to get creative again. And so what we're looking at, and you'll see as I go further down in my presentation, that our group is doing a lot of work in the Hudson Bay in the north, and more is required to engage communities in the research. And so what we're looking at and doing now is, can we think of an alternative, something new, that would be aimed more at training internship programs 18 to 30, so going back to what we learned during the Circumpolar Inuit Field Program. Maybe applying that, linking it to northern colleges, being very experiential, very hands-on, so in a research environment, because that's what we do, on ship or land, because we now know we can do both. And we would like to pilot something this July. So we don't know what the name's going to be. We don't know who our new collaborators are going to be. But we're excited that this is presenting us and a chance to think again, something new. Whatever it turns out to be, we're going to be working with, this is because this is a partnerships with the Town of Churchill and Church and Northern Studies Center and the Frontier School Division. They've recently approached us because they're partners in a lot of the research we're doing up north. They recently approached us to say, well, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we could do a science academy out of the Duke of Marlborough School in Churchill, Manitoba, where kids from the south would come to the north to study science. And they would be a real link to, they would have access to scientists who are working at the Churchill Marine Observatory or the scientists that are working at the Churchill Northern Studies Center. And we said, yeah, that would be really cool. Like in Canada, we have hockey academies. I don't know, you probably don't have them here. But there are high schools that are hockey academies. They do all the curriculum coursework, but they spend a lot of the 4 hours a day. They're in the rink. They're training for hockey. And these are kids who are serious about hockey. Well, the same thing could be done with kids who are serious about science. And so we said, certainly, we're sitting around the table. We're at the table with these guys talking. We would like to provide whatever, we would like that this would be aligned to whatever they're doing so that we're not duplicating and that we're aligned to what their needs are. And they're looking, it's a very conceptual stage right now. These are the groups, the Frontier School Division, the town, the Northern Studies Center, the province of Manitoba is behind this. They think it's neat, it's creative. And it's a vision. We did a visioning exercise. It's just really positive because sometimes you hear in the media, especially, you know, oh, Churchill, the port is closing down, and everyone's talking about the township closing down. Then you've got the mayor who's saying, hold on here. We have a vision. We want, like, we're not going to think that in that direction. We're going to think in this direction. So it's a very positive thing that's happening with high school education. So those are the things we're doing basically at the high school, mostly targeted to high school. Because we think that's the audience that really connects with our group. Because the science, we have found that through Schools on Board program, on board the ship, really our grade 10, grade 11 is a perfect age group to work with our scientists because they can understand the science, basic science. The grade 10s, 11s, 11 especially, they can get it to a little higher level. And so our scientists can really challenge them intellectually and thinking about what careers they want. And they haven't quite yet made decisions about where they're going to, what they want to do at university. So now communications and public engagement. So now I want to talk to you about just some of the different things we do to communicate in general. We use the websites. We have two. I manage two websites. So one is the one for the center. So. If you want to learn more about what we're doing, it's umanitoba.ca/CEOS. And we keep this fairly updated with news. We're trying to develop a culture within our own group. Like these are mostly used both for internal communications and external communications because we can't do the level of communications we want if we don't develop this culture within our own group. Like we have a fairly large group now, and one of the challenges as we grew, we knew this was going to be a challenge. We knew we would have to work on internal communications and develop a community amongst ourselves that would continue to support these things. So writing stories when you're in the field, it doesn't happen on its own. You need faculty members who support these initiatives, who tell their students to do this, and then you put it on Facebook, you put it on Twitter, you rotate it between websites, and you get the message out. But without putting some effort into internal communications within your group as you grow bigger, it's a constant battle if you don't do it right from the try to develop this community. So that's kind of what we've done with these two. This is the Arctic Science Partnership. It's managed again by just two volunteers from each of the centers. And what we planned was that we would each have our home websites that we would feed into this, and likewise. And it just really helps when we're using the social media. It raises your profile in Google. And when people start searching you, things can happen a lot faster. They find you more easily. So we do Facebook. We post things that are happening from the field. This is ongoing. There's a lot of student involvement within our group because they're already doing it. You know, they're already in the field. They're doing it in their own home pages. So we started to tap into that. Twitter, we've started. I'm not a great person. I don't understand it well enough. My hair is not the right color. I rely a lot on our graduate students to do it, but there's so many nice mechanisms now that I can link a Facebook post, it'll automatically be posted to Twitter, and it just happens automatically. So that's helping us out. And you know, like this, like we now have 745 followers, but the thing that Twitter does that Facebook doesn't necessarily do is it boosts us into this international and multi-sectoral. It's not just the science people. Like I'm constantly getting, you have a new follower. And it can be a government person, from Norway and Denmark. And it's very interesting to see who decides to follow us. And it's audiences we never, ever would have been able to capture. We've done a lot of books and publications, everything from during the International Polar Year, we did a Two Ways of Knowing book, which was more like a coffee book. Told a lot of beautiful pictures, had a lot of personal stories of researchers and why they got into Arctic research. Had a whole section of the people in the local communities that work with us. It was more of a general coffee table book that would reach a lot of different people. The proceeds of that book, we were able to manage to get very little costs associated with producing that book. It was all sponsored. So 100% of the sales of that book have gone into a scholarship fund that we now funds Arctic research, young graduate students coming out of our program. So as a buddy to that book, we knew that we'd still had to communicate the results of our study. So we did a soft book cover with all the results, a little more technical. And we participated in different publications, like this was the Polar Science and Global Climate Change. This is all during IPY, an international community of education and outreach communications people put together this book on how to do it, best practices, some examples around the world of what people were doing. So I participated in that process and wrote a chapter for that. And this is ongoing, like we're in the middle of doing something else. I don't think I have the video now that I put it on your machine, but this was a nice little video that we do videos and documentaries whenever we can, and it's all, again, it's a collaborative effort. This was a little video on the Schools on Board program, but it was a collaboration with our at university. We have a marketing communications office, and so we work with them a lot, and when we have a good idea, we present it to them, and it's been a really great working relationship in very little time. We just have to organize a few interviews with them and give them a bunch of pictures, and we have so much imagery, nice pictures to work with, that we've been able to get some really nice videos done. We're working right now, Build Films is a local film company, and they're working with ArcticNet to do, as ArcticNet winds down, they're doing a full documentary, it's called Breaking Ice. And it's going to be released at the next ArcticNet conference in Quebec City. And it's a celebration of what we've done. And so they're doing a smaller Schools on Board version as well, a celebration of the 14 years of doing outreach. So it's something to look forward to, and we're going to continue to promote it. Like I said, I get a lot done by working, having a very close relationship with our University of Manitoba Marketing Communications Office. Like, they have to do the whole university, and sometimes I feel like they should be just ours. But we get a lot of stuff done. Like, they do special issues on their research news. They'll do features on our students for their student pages. They do. They have a big campaign at the airport, so they started buying these big columns. And this is Soren. I came down from a trip. Dave and I came in. We were coming back from a trip. We get down to the arrivals area, and there's this huge column. It's like, there's Soren. And it's just really great. You know, when you have a strong working relationship. And definitely, they're investing a lot of money in our research, so they really want us to help them tell our stories as well, so they can promote our successes. During the International Polar Year, again, David led one of the largest Arctic research program in the world. It was called the Circumpolar Flawlead System Study. And we got a lot of, we put into that proposal, I think the success of our project was that David, right in this research proposal, wrote in education and outreach. So it gave us extra money to do the Circumpolar Interview Field Program. We did 3 international schools on board programs, and we did an artists on board program. We brought media on board. This was very a really fun project to work with. Vincent Ho, he was the composer in resident at the Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra. He came on board, joined our group during our Inuit field program, and he spent 2 weeks on the ship with our schools on board program. And out of that, so he's here getting inspired. If you look at his notebooks, and you look at a scientist's MOOC and all the numbers and all the graphs, and you see his, and it's all notes and it's all squibbles, and just to see what he was doing to inspire writing a symphony. So he wrote a 50-minute symphony that was prepared. It took a year for it to be written, and then it was in 2010. The symphony was showcased at, we have an international new music festival every year. The Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra has this in February. The symphony was presented here, but they gave the Arctic the theme for the entire festival. So it was a whole new audience. The presentation included imagery so it wasn't just a symphony, it was a multimedia. All these images were images taken by a photographer who was on board every leg of the project. The images were timed with the symphony, and the concert was preceded by a 20-minute talk. So David did a science talk to the symphony audience. So it was something, you know, we were trying. It was very successful, and it was something we've had a lot of fun playing around with. We had another composer. He's with the Manitoba Chamber Orchestra. Did the same thing. He brought his message to the north. After he did his experience, he started working with young kids in northern communities and bringing the work he got he passed that on through all of his interactions with the schools, young children in northern communities. So we had carvers on board. We have a water a painter, an artist. We also, during that project, we did a media competition working with the World Federation of Science Journalists. And that was, again, an interesting coming together of everyone meeting their different needs. The World Federation of Science Journalists held a competition David provided media berths on board the ship. And they developed a competition to see who around open to media around the world to see who would want to spend a couple of weeks on board the ship working with scientists. So for every leg of this the research project, we had 2 media berths available. And it resulted in 145 applicants from 46 different countries. 15 journalists came on board from 12 countries, Canada, France, Guatemala, India, Italy, Lebanon, Netherlands, Russia, Spain, Switzerland, UK, and USA. And we ended up with stories everywhere, in fashion magazines in Italy, in places that we would never, ever expect. And it was, again, there's a report online, and it shows all of the outputs. And it wasn't, and even just, they had 145 applicants. All of those applicants had to apply with a story of climate change and how it related to, how it touched their country and what was important to them. And so even before we even started the project, we created 145 stories about climate change at not just polar, but mid-latitude countries. which was a big focus of International Polar Year, was how do you get the kind of, how do you get people who aren't living close to the poles or aren't Arctic or polar nations, how do you get them interested in climate change? And so that was one of the focus, and then one of the reasons for the selection of who was came on board. We wanted to get a good cross-section. So again, then we just do public tours and talks, and that's, you know, again, but getting back to my point that if we don't build this culture, like these are graduate students that are interacting with people, it's just this constant effort to continue to get our group engaged in and have them see the value and the importance of communicating their work. And these are little, these are safe environments for people to test out their abilities to communicate with people and share their ideas and their work. And as they get better and better, they start to venture into different outreach opportunities. They're more likely to say yes to some of the opportunities that come across. We've worked with museums, aquariums, zoos, outdoor education facilities, and these are new. Like these are all new exhibits at our zoo. This is the Fort White Center. Now they have as a result of our day, they promote Arctic science and a cultural exchange education program. They do this on an ongoing basis now. They do it now with the 4-year-olds, but we provide them with an Arctic science kit that they do what we do with high school kids, but they just do it with their little 4-year-olds. And it's been, you know, it happens without us even being involved. This is the zoo. They did a whole new retro and a new building. They have the Journey to Churchill exhibit. And our group was quite involved in providing them some of the science and background and some of the working with them to make sure that the information that they're including in their facilities are new. This is a new and exciting project. This is my new project that I'm really excited about. As we started to do more work in Churchill, David and I are driving to work one day, and it's like, okay, we've got all these projects happening. You know, we need a new way to communicate it. What are some ideas? And so, this is what I'm talking. These are some of the, just an example of some of the projects. David talked to us about some of them, but this is our Hudson Bay, and these are in our group right now as we speak. These are projects that are happening, and so we thought, wouldn't it be great to get approach Via Rail and see if they would like to participate, partner with us, create a platform that we could communicate our work to, because they run a train that goes from Winnipeg. And it's got the funkiest route, and mostly because of the instability of the tracks. It goes into here, goes into Saskatchewan, up here, and here, and here. Like, and this is a 7-hour drive. This is a 52-hour trip. So they've got a captive audience. Most of them are coming. There's a lot of, it supplies the northern communities, but a lot of tourism is coming through Churchill on the train. And we got a captive audience. It would be a great platform to showcase what we do at the University of Manitoba and why is it a gateway to Arctic research? Why is Churchill so relevant as an Arctic research center and has been attracting researchers there for the last 250 years? So we approached Via Rail right off the bat because we needed their train, and if they didn't want to play, they had the sandbox we wanted to play in, so that wouldn't go any further. But they came up and said, yes, absolutely, they've done it. What we want to do is shrink or just wrap one of the cars and use the inside of it as a platform to communicate. So this is our train station in Winnipeg. You come through the station here, you go right through into a New Forks development. It's a International Human Rights Museum, brand new. Lots of activity happening now. This walkway used to be just in the train station, used to be just industrial behind here and parking lots. Now this is it's a walkway that takes you through this really great tourist area in Winnipeg. So not only are they doing the train, but they're also providing us with a train station and the baggage area that is part of this walkway to create some kind of a platform here that will coincide with what we're trying to do in the train. So the University of Manitoba came on board big time because an opportunity for them to also educate the public about what they do and their role in Arctic science. So this is what we're doing. So the University of Manitoba, having them on board, brought their big communications firm on board. So they work with McKim Communications in Winnipeg, and McKim Communications is the big communication firm for the Trail Manitoba, for the new Assiniboine Park Journey to Churchill exhibit. And they captured our concept right away and instantly what we wanted to achieve. So this is pretty well what it's going to look like. It's called Expedition Churchill, A Gateway to Arctic Research. Our partners, once we had VIA on board, Town of Churchill was on board right away. It promotes tourism and science tourism to Churchill. It also helps, and their motivation isn't just the tourism. It's educating their own community members about some of the research, some of the underlying concepts of the science behind the research. So they're on board. Churchill Northern Studies is working with us on a lot of these research projects, but they have a huge education mandate, and so they're on board. Travel Manitoba. They do wonderful work. Like they are award-winning company. They do award-winning campaigns on promoting tourism in Manitoba. They said with this project, because we are also promoting the Assiniboine Park Journey to Churchill exhibit, and that because they do research in the Arctic, that they came on board as well to help us promote this. So it's about an $850,000 program when you consider the in-kind contributions people are bringing to this. So once it's finished, Travel Manitoba will be in full swing on promoting this, and all of our partners will be promoting it. We want to do the interior of the train this way. It'll promote the Aurora season. Right now it's just brown. All the tables are going to have a theme. They're going to have a very vivid image of the theme that it coincides with an ebook that we're creating. And on the tables, it'll give you the website to go to, www.expeditionchurchill.com, where people will be able to download an ebook prior to their departure, so that when they get to Churchill, whenever. And it won't be limited to just the train people. We're going to be promoting this through the airport, through all of the mechanisms, so that anyone going to Churchill who's interested in knowing more about the research and about the bay, and we'll be able to go and download this app. So we're hoping the audience is going to be huge. It's not going to be limited to just people who travel on the train, but the train is definitely a nice hook to catch people's attention. We'll have the ebook downloaded onto these kiosks with this a scene that. An image that is consistent with the design of the whole campaign. And the kiosks are right now, they'll be located here. So people will be able to just go right up to the kiosk and flip through the book and learn about what we're doing. And we're hoping to build that. We're in negotiations right now with the Winnipeg Airport to put a couple kiosks there. Stage two of this will be in years. This is a three-year commitment. I forgot to say that. Like VIA, all those partners have committed to do this for 3 years. So, and then after 3 years, we will just evaluate. But honestly, once it's on, it's planned so that it's going to be managed on its own. Like the people who buy the kiosks, they troubleshoot, they manage it. When it's theirs, it's like buying this laptop. It's yours to manage. On the train, as long as the wrap stays, I'm sure that. Yeah, after 3 years, VIA probably won't say, hey, take it down. It's not like a silver bullet Coors Light wrap that they've done in the past. It's very much aligned with what they want to do. So we're going to engage, we've got this part happening with the community. We're going to engage the high school in creating an activity book that we're going to then produce with the help of Manitoba Tourism. In doing it very professional, and it'll be distributed to all the centers that are working. The activity book will be integration of Indigenous local knowledge. And then part of this program is also visitor access to CMO and engagement with scientists. So we're going to develop some kind of a mechanism for making that happen. And then putting scientists on the train. We're going to be sending graduate students on the train. To interact with the public and to interact with some of the operators. And at a very relaxed, nothing too set in stone, something that that's going to be manageable for everybody. We're going to launch this in July 2017, which is happening very quickly. and it's going to be part of the ship will be in the Hudson Bay as part of its basis project. It's doing a full bay system study. The ship arrives in Churchill on the 5th of July, And prior to that, we're going to be doing a community visit in Churchill and Chesterfield Inlet, where we bring the ship to the community. We open the door, we invite the community in, there are stations all over the ship, and people can ask and see questions from scientists and see what they do. That's something that we do quite regularly with the Amundsen. So after, we'll have a visit here, and then we'll be in Churchill. It arrives on the 5th. We're going to open our doors to the community of Churchill. We're going to be doing a sort of a VIP knowledge exchange workshop as well on the ship. That'll be hosted by our president of the university, Minister Jim Carr, who's natural resources, and the commissioner of the Coast Guard. So it's going to be a high-level knowledge exchange workshop, bringing high-level decision makers from the communities as well as our all levels of our government on board the ship for a half day, where we'll actually take the ship out to the bay and show to a research station and show them how some of the operations, and then engage in a discussion in our boardroom or conference room about some of the pressing issues and some of the concerns that people have about some of the things that are happening, like David already implied about the shipping, the mining, the opening up of the port and so there's lots to talk about. And we're gonna create that platform for that to happen. But we're also going to launch Expedition Churchill. The train will leave on the Tuesday, the 4th. It'll travel on the 5th. The ship will be in Churchill. And on the 6th, the train will arrive in Churchill. And so it'll be an open house on the train with scientists on the train just to launch this. So we're really excited about it. It's a lot of fun, and people are getting behind it. And that has been the key, is trying to find things that people can get excited about as much as you are. I wanted to talk about some of the engagement we do with communities, because I think a lot of people in here might be interested in that based on our discussions prior to this talk. Our group is a large group, and more and more, we do a lot of community engagement with the work. Through the Arctic Net, David talked about Arctic Net a little bit. It's been 2004-2018. Arctic Net is a consortium of researchers from across Canada, but it also, through its 14 years of planning research expeditions, they plan an expedition every year through the Arctic and back. And at the end of the 14, the, by the end of the period, there's a whole integrated regional impact studies process. Am I getting this right, David? That the process is intended to, at the end of this 14-year period, to bring together the knowledge that all the scientists have accumulated for those regions. And the process is not just the scientists, it's very much an engagement with the communities throughout the accumulation of the content, the content that goes into the reports. There's two of these reports that have already been published. The University of Manitoba leads right now this whole IRIS in the Beaufort and Western Arctic and the Hudson Bay. So it's out of these four regions, our University of Manitoba leads two of them, which is pretty significant contribution. I wanted to just show you the level of engagement. So this is just a scattering of some of the projects we have. And I'm not going to read all the slides. I'll let you read some of them, and I'll try to go through these fairly quickly. But this is this just shows you, I just wanted to give an example of some of the community engagement and the community-based monitoring programs that are happening through our group. So if we go here to the Beaufort Sea, we've got one of our researchers who's adjunct with the Fisheries and Oceans Canada. She does beluga studies in the Beaufort Sea. You'll notice that a lot of we're a sea ice group. So I've tried to show you some of the things that we do with the community-based monitoring and some of the engagement that happens. And then in here, some of the concerns of the local people. And why they're getting involved in these projects with our scientists. And for the sustainable use of resources, climate change impacts on habitat, food security, contaminants, sea ice is an ongoing concern throughout most of these. So I think I can go through these fairly quick, and I just want to give you a sense of the diversity of the projects. We're moving more, if you look back at Lisa, she describes her work as, you know, multiple evidence-based, and that we've really leaned, we're moving more towards that. You know, way back even before IPY, we used to talk more about traditional ecological knowledge. Well, one of the big concerns of the Inuit and communities is that unpredictability of that traditional knowledge. And so a lot of our work right now is using multiple evidence. So you've got traditional knowledge, you've got local knowledge, you have indigenous knowledge, you've got many, many different scientific knowledge. So it's a little bit more inclusive to refer to this as multiple evidence-based, and that's where we're moving towards as a group. The Shingle Point, again, sustainable use of marine resources, their impacts on habitat. Beaufort Regional says changes in sea ice. So we have, in all these situations, we have local people working with us, collecting data, collecting and monitoring, and working side by side. To area two, that's the Sachs Harbor. That was the IPY project that I talked about. In this project, this was a year-round project, and this was very, we had a very large piece involving a whole team. There's not 10 research teams. One of the research teams was led by Inuit. It was all Inuit led, and their task was to gather traditional knowledge for that area relevant to the study area and our research objectives. We had a Inuit policy workshop on board the ship, so while the ship was in ice, we brought in policymakers, Inuit Circumpolar Council, representatives from all of the countries, came on board the ship for a one-week exchange, and they came out, what came out of that was an Amundsen statement. They came together and put together a statement that they could then communicate to the world, basically, during IPY, what their position was. And like I said already, we did the Two Ways of Knowing book, we did the Inuit Field Program, we did a whole Circumpolar Indigenous Youth Leaders Program at the Knowledge Workshop Conference in Montreal. And again these very similar concerns that they bring to the table and bring to researchers. This is a statement. It's available online. It can be Googled and searched and found. And it's for those of you who are interested in policy and connections, it's called the ICC Amundsen Statement, and you can find it online. I found it just a post on here. So we get closer, Cambridge Bay. We have a group of researchers. They've been going there for a couple years now, and this is fun because they started to implement our Arctic Science Day, the thing we do at Fort White. So they use the same model. We use 35 scientists and 200 students. You can do it with 3 scientists and 10 students, the same kind of model. But they brought in the whole community to their site one day, and they engaged. They showed the elders what they're doing, and it was just letting people know what it is that they're doing. And they do have Inuit collaborators in their project as well. And while they're in town, they do the school visits. They try to communicate their work to the school. This is a Chesterfield Inlet. It's up in north part of the bay. They're working very closely. Wager Bay, they've got a new national park there, Canadian National Park. The Park Canada group are doing a lot of ecosystem monitoring, baseline monitoring, and working with our researchers. They began their concerns, increased shipping, there's a mine being proposed right near the park. So a lot of concerns and a lot of wanting to be involved in a lot of what the research and monitoring. And the Hudson Bay, this is, I've already talked about our very many projects. One of them is a Transport Canada project looking at climate change and marine transportation in Hudson Bay. David already talked about that, but it's all about, you know, looking at the corridors, and so this is an ongoing program that we have. And this is just bringing in some of Jackie's slides, a collaborator with the University of Ottawa, and just supports. She was just visiting our lab just a couple weeks ago, and wanting to collaborate more with our group because what we're doing in the Hudson Bay is very relevant to what she's doing. And what she's finding is this historically weak relationship between shipping activities in the toll area, and then up until now, and then you can start to really see that there is a stronger relationship. She's looking at working with a lot of, she's in Ottawa, so she has a close relationship with Transport Canada. They're looking at these corridors, and you can't see this here, but what she says is they have the corridors marked out here. Then in another map, they look at the corridors, and it's like, holy, you know, you've got all these protected areas. You've got these in purple is the sites that are significant cultural sites for the Inuit. So there's this need to collaborate, or else, you know, as we develop and move forward in identifying these transport routes. And so she and her group are now already done these consultations with the communities where they're mapping them out, and they're bringing this information to the table. And so they've done this. They're looking at a different set of workshops. So these are the ones that they've done so far. And it's just, you know, just showing that there, you know, this stuff does not happen in isolation of the communities, that there's a lot of engagement and involvement. This is our Hudson Bay project that David talked about. With that project, we have consultation with communities at the Hudson Bay Roundtable, community visits, the expedition we're ongoing right now. Their biggest, the study is really looking at hydroelectric regulation impacts on the bay. How that's changing. Very linked, and there's another project I'll show you, but David talked about the Gen Ice program. So there's so much to communicate. There's so much happening. The Gen Ice is a Genome Canada program, this is a national funding agency that supports these kind of projects. And we were successful this year in getting one through their call for large-scale environmental programs. And it's aligned to David's, the Churchill Marine Observatory. It's the first large-scale program that's going to be happening out of the Churchill Marine Observatory. It's going to do its first year of sampling on board the Amundsen this year in the bay, as part of the BASIS project. They're going to be on board collecting water samples. And part of all Genome Canada projects, you have to, when you do your proposal, you have to have what they call a GELS team. And it's a requirement. And the GELS stands for genomics, and it's environmental, economic, ethical, legal, and social issues. It's a huge task. When you put the proposal together, you have to at least address some of these. You can focus on a few, but you have to address it. This project, I was part of the proposal writing on the GELS team, and they're putting together, they want to identify the stakeholders, and we're talking stakeholders, scientist stakeholders, and community stakeholders, and creating knowledge exchange workshops and getting people engaged in, you know, what do they know about genomics, what do they know, and what do they need to know in order to move forward in becoming better prepared to deal with the possibility of oil spills or fuel leaks. And that's becoming more of a concern than oil spills. There's a lot of shipping happening right now with tourism and mining and just general shipping. So they want to engage in these workshops. So this is right now happening as is in the works right now. And then 6 and 7, we have a nice little project up in the east side of Hudson Bay. This is a new project with the Cree Nation. It's got a community-driven research, a collaboration with the Arctic Eider Society. Again, their concern is hydroelectric development. They're finding changes to the freshwater inputs into the marine system. One of the concerns, eelgrass is a habitat for snow geese. They're finding a decrease in eelgrass. One trying to understand what it's from. Is it from any of these regulations? Is it just due to climate change? But it's a concern for them because this is part of the food they rely on. So they're very involved. These are all Inuit partners that are actually engaged in collecting water samples and working with the scientists side by side. If you go to the Eider Society, Arctic Eider Society, this is part of a whole integrated knowledge, the integrated knowledge maps. And so these are our researchers here. This is their website. This is the research team talks about stuff. But you can go and click on any of, it's incredible. You can click on any of these sites and you get even more detail. And these are buoys and these are sensors. And this shows you where the ducks are and where they see the seals. And so it's bringing together the local knowledge with the scientists. And you can actually click, there's real time sensors. So, you know, on January 20th, the salinity readings off the sensors. So it's a very, very involved website that they've worked with the communities, with Eider Society, to make knowledge and information available in real time to people. And then we have a small project here in Lake Melville. Again, this one is a community health impact. So a lot of examples, a lot of led by our faculty members. A lot of the ways that we communicate, like I said, to the IRIS reports, especially for the accumulated knowledge of ArcticNet, these are all geared to be synthesis reports that are geared to policymakers. And like I said, you can find two of them. Time out. This is your laptop. It's plugged in. I think I got disconnected from the.
Let's see here.
Your projector went off, maybe.
Yeah.
I think it did.
I guess that's enough talking for.
Sorry, that's it. It is pretty well. So yeah, so those reports. So there's a lot of requirements from our team, and the bigger the project's got, and like Dave says, the more funding you put into research, really obviously the more accountable you have to be to that research, and the more effort you have to put into it. Certainly, coming out of International Polar Year, there was a desire to the really recognized need that we need to communicate. That the results are happening, the changes are happening so fast that scientists need to have some kind of mechanism to communicate that beyond the publications that take a couple of years to write and get out, and even then they're not available to people. And as we see with the transportation stuff, the shipping corridors, you've got levels of government that are trying to meet these needs and are really trying to do it almost blind if they don't have science or some of the evidence base to support. So. Yeah, and we're getting more involved with industry. We're getting more involved in that kind of research that has more implications to society, especially like if you see the list of the projects I listed out there. So I think that was it. Honestly, there was just a couple more slides that just made because there was people talking. We were talking about tourism and just about that whole push for tourism and the Crystal Serenity that went up. A lot of ethical issues associated with those. I just have a slide that points you to, going to the CBC did a very interesting news reporting on this Crystal Serenity. It's a 13-minute video, so I wasn't going to show it to you, but I've got the link. Honestly, if you're interested in that, sit down, because if you watch it, it has the perspectives of the industry, like the tour guy. He's in his. He go to his office building, his really elaborate office building, and he talks about his, he just thinks that it's everybody's right to be able to see what they want to see. If it's a remote landscape, if it's endangered or it's no one's right to tell them not that they can't. So that's the perspective he's bringing to the table. And then you see the communities that they come and visit, and you hear all of the concerns that's, came after that first visit. It's a learning process, and if you look at it, it is very much a learning process. The communities, I don't think, even knew what to expect when the ship, they knew the big ship was going to come, but they were talking about very small, remote subsistence communities that are very poor to and rely on, so some of the things that were happening weren't well coordinated. It's something that if this moves forward, there's no reason to believe it's not going to continue to move forward, that there'll be a learning process between the communities telling the tour organizers, okay, last time, nah, that didn't work. Next time we'll do it this way. And there's some communities, and I'll show there isn't, if I get on them again, there's a really nice example from Pond Inlet that Jackie shared with us. That afterwards, they prepared a brochure. And they were very well organized, and that's what we're finding too with engagement communities. We're starting to, there is a desire to get involved in this. They see this as opportunities. They just need help in doing it more wisely, or help in the planning of it, so that when the tours are coming in, it meets the expectations. So they found in the first one that. The communities were coming with all these things to sell, but some of the things people couldn't buy because they weren't allowed to take them back home. And in other times, they were just buying little things. So the expectation of the communities was way different than the expectations. So it's like planning outreach programs. If you create win-win situations, you have to make sure that the expectations on both sides are aligned. And I think that's going to happen through these experiences. So next time Crystal Serenity wants to go into town, there'll be people saying, well, hold on, there's a landing fee now, because now we want to make sure everybody benefits from you coming into town. And there's no guarantee you're buying anything. You're just coming to town, taking a big gawk at everything, taking pictures inappropriately in inappropriate places, and we're not benefiting. You leave, and we can have pride, and we, you know, we feel pride that you came to our town, and we were able to share our culture, but we didn't gain much financially from it. So I think it'll be interesting to see how this whole thing moves forward, because it's definitely going to be more, I think, as the Arctic opens up. You'll have more people like the big tour operator who says, but...
Are you up for questions?
Yes, I am.